Okay, so now we're going to start talking about depression. And you can see here, this is, if you look in DSM-4, they're going to say lifetime prevalence rate is 17%. Well, you know, this is probably not correct, and I'll tell you why. And it's because it's looking like a lot of people that have what present as recurrent or chronic depression may in fact have a variant of bipolar disorder based on new epidemiological studies. DSM-5 is supposed to come out in 2012. Did I mention the website yet for that? Did I mention it last time? Yep. Okay, you know that. So you can get online, you know, and check out and see kind of what's happening right now. The first draft is out. The World Health Organization did a study that looked at 14 different countries, and what they found was that several things. One, in primary care medical settings, and actually basically the results they found were similar across countries, okay? Look at this. Depression, the second most common disorder seen in primary care. The first is hypertension, high blood pressure, okay? The second is depression, and the third is, guess what, anxiety disorders. One out of four, next time you go to your primary care doctor, one out of four people sitting there have depression whether they know it or not, okay? So extraordinarily common. In primary care settings, the diagnostic hit rate in picking up depression is 40%, which I would say is not bad because they're spending 10 or 15 minutes with their physician, but that means there's also a lot of people who are either not diagnosed or, even worse, they're misdiagnosed as having depression, unipolar depression, when in fact they have bipolar disorder, okay? One reason that they have low hit rate is because of the last line on here. 87% don't come in and say, I feel blue, I feel suicidal, I feel sad, or what have you. They're presenting with somatic complaints, headaches, fatigue is a big thing. Half of people with depression have chronic headaches, sexual dysfunction, you know, sleep disorders and so forth. And yet this is where most of the treatment, the medical treatment, as we talked about before, is occurring in primary care medical settings. This is, they collapsed data across 14 countries, and what they said, and what one of the countries was the United States, and these are not third world countries. They're primarily, you know, countries in Asia and Europe and Canada and that sort of thing, okay? Also, I guess I don't have a slide up here that says that I thought I did, but they project that by the year 2020, worldwide depression will be the second most debilitating illness. And currently, it's the second most debilitating illness among women worldwide, and men are going to catch up. So this is a big deal. And actually, the World Health Organization has and you can get on their website and look at all the details, has said that we believe that the prevalence of depression is actually increasing, and it's not just that people are diagnosing it better, but that it is actually increasing. And there's probably a number of good reasons that we'll take a look at that might account for that. This also you will not find in DSM-4. It used to be thought that about half of people that had a major depressive episode would have one episode and that's it. That's really not the case. It's this. You know, vast majority are having recurrent depressions or having chronic depressions. And so really the name of the game in treatment, of course, this would be true for psychotherapy and other treatments like exercise and so forth, but we're talking about medication treatment. But the name of the game is not only resolving the current episode, but also with a real eye towards relapse prevention. Okay, and clearly the early warning sign list that is developed between the patient and their significant other is aimed at trying to catch new episodes before they get too severe. Yeah.
So are you saying that those that have the single episode are better at, they have a better response to the medication as well as the prevention aspect of it, or is it just that 20% of people only have a single episode?
Yeah, that's right. This is kind of regardless of treatment.
Okay. And so do you know if there have been any studies to see what differentiates those groups?
Excellent question. Her question was, do I know studies that have looked at, okay, how are these people different? I mean, are they different genetic factors or what have you? And there are a number of studies, and we may talk about a couple of those, but right now, I don't think anybody really knows the answer to that question. Okay, everybody should be presumed to be at risk for recurrence, and warn, and once they get off medication, warn to look for the early warning signs. Okay. Fluctuating course, and this study, some of you in the back, the little tiny stuff just for me to remember to mention this, but this was the 12-year follow-up study of 400 and some patients. A fourth of them was first episode, half of them had recurrent depression. But look at this, during 12-year follow-up, these people, now these were people who had sought out treatment, okay? This is not an epidemiologic study. These are people in a treatment, which means it's probably even worse, people that aren't getting treated. But take a look at this, 58% of the time they're symptomatic over a period of 12 years. We're talking about not months of exposure, but years of exposure. And when you look at things like we talked about last time, like hypercortisolemia, if you get exposed to that for years and years and years, then it could really take a toll in terms of causing brain damage. Now, 15% accounts for major depression, okay? But subsyndromal depression is seen a lot more. And this is where people have partial recoveries, which we'll talk more about after a while. They can function. They're probably not going to kill themselves, but life is not okay. You know, they don't feel okay. They feel, especially quality of life issues, which are rarely measured on depression rating scales. People, you know, it's like they'll look pretty good on a depression rating scale, but you ask them, but how do you feel? I don't know. I feel like crap. You know, I mean, I don't feel like I used to. Okay. So again, just a testament to how recurrent this is. When I was in graduate school, and you still hear somebody talk about this, making this distinction between a reactive depression and endogenous depressions, and like they're different. And it was assumed for a long time that depressions sort of came out of the blue in the absence of any psychosocial stressors, maybe endogenous, and clearly that certainly may be the case. It can be caused by also exposure to certain medications, certain diseases like thyroid disease, and so on and so forth. But really the bottom line is this, two things. One is the so-called endogenous disorders, especially bipolar disorder, absolutely are reactive as well. Now there can be people that have bipolar and they're not being treated or they stop taking their medicine and it's not especially bad thing happening in their life and they have a breakthrough manic episode. Okay, so it can be spontaneous episodes, but not infrequently you'll see people that'll come in, especially for depression, okay? And you say, why do you think you're depressed? And they will offer, they'll tell you what's going wrong in their life. They've had their marriages is going down the tubes. You know, they've had their father died or something like that. These are bona fide significant life stressors, and it has triggered depression, but it may be triggering in somebody who has bipolar disorder. Okay, so just keep in mind, some of these disorders are so strongly rooted in genetic vulnerability. Also, often the episodes are triggered by life stressors, okay? And most severe depressions at some point start taking on these biological symptoms that are, for a long time have been sort of the hallmark of the more biologically based depressions. And here are the biologic symptoms, and we know all of these. The reason anhedonia is on the list is because there's some pretty clear evidence that it's one of the symptoms that is significantly associated with neurobiologic changes, especially decreased availability of dopamine. We'll come back and talk about treatment implications later.